All right, let's talk about alpha carbon alkylations with Michael type nucleophiles. And so when I say alkylation, I mean that we're going to form an enolate of the alpha carbon of our functional group, and then we're going to attack an alkyl group attached to a leaving group to form a new carbon-carbon bond. So if we look at what we've got here, we've got an unsymmetrical ketone that has two different alpha carbons. So that's the one scenario where we've got to pick which side we're going to bias towards the enolate formation. And at negative 78 degrees, the product of that first step would be a kinetic enolate to the less substituted side. At 0 degrees, we'd go to the more substituted side. Well, in the second step, we're going to accomplish the alkylation at the alpha carbon by adding our primary alkyl group. The final product of both of these steps will then be, keeping all of our carbons, we would then add a group to that alpha carbon. So there's the original alpha carbon from the enolate, and we're going to say that this leaving group here is a random R group. Okay, but a primary alkyl group is necessary because it's an SN2 type reaction, and we're trying to avoid E2 competition from the enolate reacting as a base with our alkyl halides. So stick to primary alkyl halides. With our enolate, an alkylation involving these beta difunctionalized nucleophiles, they're going to actually be good nucleophiles and weak bases. So beta keto esters, beta diketones, we'll see several of these have pKas that are less than 16, or so we'd say 14 to make sure that we have a good efficient proton transfer with a base like hydroxide or methoxide, a good middle range power base there. So pKa less than 14 for these ultimate nucleophiles that we're going to make from our starting material. They're milder options. They're preferred whenever we can use them over LDA enolates because of the safety factor and dangers associated with using LDA. Ultimately, the product of the first step, as we'll see in a moment, is an enamine. We do the alkylation and then we will hydrolyze with acid. So ultimately, it turns out that when we do have two different alpha positions, if we with our alpha, or excuse me, with our unsymmetrical ketone, it still prefers to form an enamine just like it was with the enolate at the less substituted carbon in general, say for the most part. Okay, we then add our alkyl group and then hydrolyze the enamine, and ultimately, the product of these steps here is the same as we saw with LDA. We add our alkyl group to that less substituted alpha carbon. Okay, but we do so in much milder conditions and much safer conditions. So we prefer to use that whenever we can. Okay, but it's an option when we have an unsymmetrical ketone or other, or symmetrical ketone for that matter. Okay, it is problematic with aldehydes, so we're going to say ketones only for forming these enamines. All right, so we do see a little bit of an issue with aldehydes with this reaction. There are ways to get around it. They're a little bit beyond the scope of the course. All right, so how does this play out in general? So let's go with the first step here. The product of this first step, like we said, was the kinetic enamine here. That's going to be useful for our next step. Okay, and we look at the mechanism of enamine formation. Secondary amines with ketones will form enamines. So there's a separate lesson on enamine formation and hydrolysis. Okay, we can take a look at. But ultimately, we're going to add our halide. Primary is best. Turns out you can get away with a secondary halide with enamine. So I might go up here and say, or secondary for enamines because they are weak bases. E2 is less of a problem, but it does complicate the reaction, slow it down. Reports are that it isn't nearly as good as with primary halides. So we'll see most examples stick with that. Ultimately, though, our enamine alkylates much like an enolate by reforming a CN double bond, attacking the primary position of our halide, kicking off the leaving group. So at the end of that first step, we redraw our original ketone carbons, and now we've got a nitrogen-carbon double bond. Four bonds to nitrogen gives it a plus one formal charge, but we've also added two carbons here from the ethyl group. Okay, so here's our original alpha carbon there, and we've got a new carbon-carbon bond. The purpose of step three is to hydrolyze this iminium that we formed. So this is a second step. This is a third step. Aqueous acid will hydrolyze our imine or iminium ion back to a ketone. We have a byproduct of protonated, what we call pyrrolidine. So this is a compound, a cyclic nitrogen compound called pyrrolidine. We'll worry about naming that later, but we have our alkylated ketone product. All right, so suppose we're using, instead of an enamine, we're using a beta diketone. So there's alpha beta, so we've got a beta diketone. We know that the alpha position has two acidic protons, one of which we'll pluck off. They're more acidic than any external alpha protons, so we don't worry about those in our first alkylation here. And so after step one, what we've done is just an acid-base reaction, and we'll show it forming the alpha carbanion, because that's the nucleophilic carbon we're going to see. We could just as easily have shown the enolate formation. Why not? Let's do that too. Let's show the enolate as well here. So instead, we form here that enolate. To either side would have been appropriate, no problem. Three resonance contributors for these disubstituted systems. So there's our enolate. Alpha carbon still in the same place. Okay. From there, we would take our nucleophile, we would add our alkyl halide. Say we add ethyl bromide again. Attack the primary position. We've just reformed a carbonyl, and we've added two carbons to that alpha carbon. So there's our alkyl group that we've added. There's our alkylation. We don't need a hydrolysis step because the ketone is the stable functional group here. Okay. We can also, with enamines, while we're on the topic, we can make an enamine and then use an acyl halide to form our beta diketone. So we just looked at a reaction of a beta diketone. How might we form that? Well, if we take an acyl halide, we can do a carboxylic acid derivative reaction with this acyl halide. So we attack it in the carbonyl position, just like we would with an enolate here, kick up to a tetrahedral intermediate. So there we go with an O minus, and we've got here a leaving group chlorine, and we just attacked with the alpha carbon. So we've got an ethyl group, but we attacked with the alpha carbon here. Try a five-membered ring a little better. I can do better than that. Maybe not. Try one more time here. There we go. Yep. And we've got our ketone, or our enamine here. Iminium has formed from the enamine. And we've got our tetrahedral intermediate. Okay, so again, where's everything at? We just attacked with the alpha carbon here. So all of this belongs together, right? And then we've got three carbons from our acyl halide that belongs together. Tetrahedral intermediate has a leaving group, so it kicks off the chloride. We've still got our iminium here. We've now got a ketone, but we need to hydrolyze the iminium in a third step here, or a sequential step. So we started with our enamine here, so a second step from where we started. And that will hydrolyze that iminium back to a ketone. We just added a ketone, and that's a beta diketone, one way to make those compounds.